everybody on the 2nd of April, Bhandara, of great master, Hazur Maharaj Baba Sawan Singh Ji, who is my master, and the master of a lot of other followers, lot of other gurus and teachers of today that we see around the world. And he was an inspiration for a number of people. So this is a day on which he left his physical body, and we commemorate him on this day every year. And so this is called the 2nd April Hazur Maharaj Baba Sawan Singh Bhandara. It's called Bhandara because Bhandara means the big treasure house. He was full of all the treasures and wealth, spiritual wealth of the world, which he shared. And his teachings were the same, which are the teachings of all the masters, of all the living masters throughout the world. So we take this opportunity to remind ourselves of those lofty teachings and how we can benefit from the presence of masters in our midst. I was exposed to this spiritual discipline at a very early age, being born to parents who had already accepted the great master as a living guru or a teacher. I grew up in that atmosphere. As a small child, I had some wonderful experiences of childhood. I used to think that those are normal experiences for people. Experience of flying around in another body, experiences of hearing sounds, music, coming from nowhere, whichever side you turn your head, it comes from that side. Those I thought were common experiences everybody used to have, but later on I found that they were not as common as I thought. I was initiated very young, at the age of about 10, and after I got initiated, a lot of those wonderful experiences that were so natural to me were all shut off, and I got nothing after that. So it was very strange. I saw other people who got initiated by the great master. Immediately after initiation or shortly thereafter, they would get inner experiences. They would hear the music which they never heard before. And here was I. I used to have all these experiences. And when I got initiated by him, all the experiences finished. So I grew up in blindness at that time. I was going to school. And the question came into my head, have I accepted this path just out of a ritual, just because my father and mother believed in this particular philosophy and this spiritual path? Or did I have a fair chance to look around and see what is the purpose of life? What are the options available to me? And did I make a choice at all? And if I am thinking I found the real guru and I found the real path and the real perfect living master, when I had seen no other master, maybe I was just fooling myself. And when I looked at other people who believed in different spiritual disciplines and religious disciplines, I found each one of them thought they knew the real thing and they had the right path. So it gave me serious concern, even at that young age. It put me into a sort of apprehension that I was following this path not because I had shopped around, looked around for it, but I was following it blindly because my parents were following it. Therefore, I was following it. Had my parents been following some other denomination, Christian denomination, I would have said that alone is true. Christ is the only savior and everybody else is heathen and knows nothing. Had I been born to Muslim parents and they would have told me the Prophet Muhammad is the only one who brought the truth, I would have said everybody else knows nothing. They'll go to hell. Only the Muslims who believe in the Prophet will go to heaven. And had I been born in an orthodox Hindu family worshipping the gods, monkey gods and other kinds of different forms, I would have said, these monkeys alone can save us. Everybody else is mistaken. They don't know the truth. And when I found people actually subscribing to these views, I realized that I could be in the same state. That I thought that great master was the great master and this was the path just because I was born into it like others were born into it. And I said, this is like getting trapped in a philosophy, getting trapped in a path which I have never had a chance to evaluate, never had a chance to compare, never got a chance to look around in the world and see what others are saying may be right or wrong. So I was very, very disturbed by this. And this disturbance was accentuated by an incident that happened shortly after I got initiated. And that was, some friends came to see my father, who was a very, very devoted disciple of Great Master. My father was so committed, he said, he's God. I don't want to question that. I have got proof. I have got my own experience. If you have some other experience, go ahead. I don't want to disturb your experience. But I have no time and no patience to investigate any further. I know Great Master is God. I believe him. He's acted like God. When I go up to him, he acts like God. I have no more questions. He was that kind of a man. And here was his son, young initiate, who said, this father is talking like this because he never saw anything else. It's blind faith, blind belief in a man. Therefore, he should see what others are saying. At that time, some friends came to see my father. And my father was very proud. You know my son Ishwar? He just got initiated. Look, he was going to be initiated with half initiation. But the great master was so kind, despite his young age, he gave him full initiation. And my father was so proud saying this. But those guests who came to him, they said, this is not a good thing that happened. Don't you realize that he has been caught so young when his mind was not mature? He had not grown up to think for himself. When he will grow up, go to college and university, and find out the benefits of a rational approach, when he will study science and see how this world is run and how all the old myths and superstitions have been broken by science, how will he react? He will react to this thing by saying, I was fooled as a child. Don't you know what happened to Nikki? So they specifically named the person. Nikki was another guy who was initiated very young. When he grew up, he reacted to it and said, I was trapped. I was fooled by my parents. They said, this is the real path. Whereas, I got no chance to find the real path. I have to find the path for myself. I have to look around for it. They just trapped me. Therefore, it is not right to catch them young. Not in the spiritual path. When those people talked like this to my father, I was overhearing, eavesdropping from the next room. And I said, how right they are. They are absolutely right. I am following this path because of the accident of being born in this family. Had I been born in any other family, I would be following the path of that family. Had I been born in another religion, I would be extolling that religion as the true one. Had I been born in another spiritual discipline, I would say that is the true one. And when I saw everybody doing it, I was convinced that I would have done the same thing elsewhere, and I am doing the same thing now, and saying, great master is great, and this is the real path, because I found it through my parents. I found it by my birth. I found by accident. At that time, I still believed that accidents take place in life. I did not know that there are no accidents. That the Lord, when he responds to our seeking, he places accidents in our way. He places the circumstances in our way in a very unique manner. I did not know fully at that time. But I did remember certain words of the great master, which he uttered when he initiated me. And those then took hold of me. And those words were, my friend, I am sharing with you what I got from my master. It helped me. It's proved useful to me. See if it proves useful to you. Try it out. I found it good.
you try it out.
But if you find anything better anywhere in the world, don't come to me to ask my permission to accept the new path. First accept it. Then come back to me and tell me about it so I may also go and accept it. This was a big challenge. Great Master said, if you can find something that gives you more than what I am sharing with you, first accept it. Then come back to me. I took it seriously. When I heard those people talking to my father, I took it more seriously. I said, my job is to look for the best path that is available, and I will go anywhere to look for it. Not that I will wait for if it comes in my way. That is as accidental as my being born to my parents. I'll go out of my way to look for the right path, something that will give me the truth, something that will give me more than I ever had, something that will convince me that God is real, that He is around, and we can reach Him, we can talk to Him, we can walk with Him, that we can alter our life and make it happy, as all the scriptures have said, as all the religions have said. I want to find the real path. So I began my search and went on for several years, and went after this relentlessly. I would cut my classes to go and attend services in the church, whatever churches were available there in India at that time. I tried all the different denominations, and I tried the very ornate Catholic churches, and I tried the Protestants and the very radical churches, and I went to the, made friend with a Muslim and went to his mosque. And the Maulvi gave me the holy water and said, now Allah will give you all the knowledge from within. And I went to the temples, and I went to the monkey gods, and I went to the goddesses, and I looked for anything that was available anywhere. And I went to gurus, one after another. They went to yogis. And I did not leave any teacher. Somebody would say, there is a man who can give you something. I would run. I'd say, maybe that's the one the great master referred to, who can give me something more. I spent years and years in this search. And meanwhile, I had lost all those beautiful experiences of childhood. I was only running mad with my rationalization, with my logic. And I said, I must have something convincing. In the meantime, when I would come back to Great Master, look at him, he would smile, laugh. Yes, keep going. He wouldn't even say it. I could see from the mischievous smile that he knew what was going on, and he said, go ahead. It's not over yet. And I knew it was not over, so I ran again. So I would try to find everything. I did Kundalini yoga. I did yoga of self-control through yogis in the Himalayan mountains who gave me special weeds so that I should be totally numbed, gave me sand to drink in the water all the time to make me cool, all kinds of stuff, to find the reality and where is the real teacher. And I tried to find out, where is the teacher? Where is the path? What is the reality? When I did all this, after years and years, I found out that not only did nobody offer me more than what the great master had offered, they did not even describe the offer. Great master said, the truth is very simple. It is inside you. You go within and find the truth. Master is also very simple power. It is not a man. It is not a person. Master is a spirit that guides you within. Go inside. Find the true master. If you don't know how to recognize the master, we will give you hints. Ask your teacher, what kind of hint do I need to recognize the master? I may just see different forms and I may think they are the true master. He will teach you how to recognize, but find the master inside, find the path inside, find the truth inside, find the happiness, and above all, find all the answers to your questions inside. This was his message, very simple. And I discovered, to my horror, that I was in the midst of a crowd of seekers, all of us suffering from one deficiency, that whereas we heard from the master, go inside and get the answers, we were all trying to get answers from outside. We wouldn't go inside. We never even tried to go inside. It was so difficult. It was terrible. Master used to say, sit in meditation for 2.5 hours and adopt certain postures so that you are alert, don't go to sleep. And we would put ourselves in that position. It was so terrible. The legs would pain, the bones would crack. And I found young and old all suffering. They couldn't do meditation. So they gave up and said, let's find some quick answers from some real gurus who are around. We were all making the same mistake. We were making the mistake of looking for something outside, which was actually inside. And since everybody made the mistake and tried to compare notes and get compassion and empathy from each other, they were all happy. Oh, we are doing fine. Why? Because everybody is miserable, so we are also happy. We began to find that our happiness was based upon everybody's general misery. So we were not following the path. Because the master's instruction was very simple. Go within and get the answers inside. The answers are waiting for you. Sometimes, by accident, an answer would come. By accident again. One would just not be very serious about meditation, but just in a relaxed mood, at meditation time, introspecting, closing one's eyes and saying, what's all this going on? Is it all real? Is it all make-believe? Is the world make-believe, or am I make-believe? Is this path make-believe? These kinds of thoughts would put one in an introspective mood. And not merely introspective mood, but just make one forget where one was sitting. Just by that thought process taking us deep inside, not trying to do meditation, but just going inside, and suddenly something would be clear that this is the answer. And one would get startled by it. This is the answer, but where did I get it from? I must have read it in some book. That is why I got it. It must be a forgotten memory. My subconscious must have pushed it up. All the more one studied the books, the more explanations came for these kinds of sudden insights, sudden answers that would come to us without explanation. But then we would think hard on them, look up the books again and say, no, this is not possible. You must go inside and see the sights and sounds. Otherwise, how can you get an answer? And those answers, we would throw them away. They are unreal. Whereas they were real answers. It took such a long time to find out that awareness and knowledge that comes from within is coming from the same source which Great Master had pointed out, is the source of all knowledge. Great Master, like all the other masters, said, within this human frame, within this body, which you think is yourself, are all the treasures of the world, all the spiritual wealth. There is no other place to go to. There is no other library. This is the library. The secret is within you. Go within. Give it first priority. When we tried to go within and give first priority, the mind would rebel against it and say, no, give it some priority, give it some importance, but what about the other things? And we would divide our attention, giving about 5-6% to the real thing inside and 95% to outside things. Books, studies, analysis, comparison, company, meetings, discourses, everything outside got large amount of our attention and a very little attention went inside. We found out the reason was very simple. It was very dark inside. We closed our eyes, it was dark. It was very boring. It was very stagnant. It looked like you could close your eyes and for hours nothing would happen. Of course, afterwards, when you felt for hours, 2 hours, nothing has happened, you saw the watch, it's only 20 minutes. But that itself showed. That showed the kind of experience we were having. So we ran away from that. So the percentage of the time we gave to high priority items on the spiritual path was so little. Then it came to me. I'm sharing this with you because I know there are so many of you who can relate to some of these things. It happened to me. I know it can happen to anyone. But what follows can also be related. I said to myself, people have told me, all the yogis I met told me how to get powers, how to get energy, how to get influence on people, how to be able to speak effectively, how to able to get at the neck of somebody else, how to, all these things they were teaching was not how to find your real home or how to find happiness and truth and how to find a way out of this mess that this whole experience seems to be. They didn't come to the real thing. But at least the great master gave an answer to that question. That this is a big mess created by our mind. You want to get out of it? Find the real way, the 10th door inside. Leave these 9 doors and go inside. So I should try that seriously. Then it came to me, why should I try? The harder I try, the less the answer I get. And when I don't try, when I am just relaxing, suddenly something comes. And then when I try hard to retain what came, that goes away. I get an answer which is so sharp and clear, when I think about it and say, is this the answer? It disappears. I go to the master, he speaks and I say he's speaking only to me. Because he's touching upon the very issues in my heart. And he's gathered the other people as extras in this show. I get that feeling. And I'm sure of it. And I go out and go home and I forget what he told me. I even forget what he said. What is this going on? Well, all right, let me start from the beginning. If he is God, then he should be able to act like God. Let me test him out. Then came a phase in my life, I would test him out. I would say, if you are really God, then I couldn't pay my bill last month. I hope the money is waiting somewhere and I can pay. Well, somebody just had to give me money, was waiting. He said, oh, I owed you some money. You know, I couldn't make it all these months. Here it is. Wow, you are not giving me the money. He's God. Because it happened now. All right, if you are God, I am going to go to the bus station. I have to take a bus to the next city. But I am getting late. The bus, if it is 5 minutes late, you are God. If I miss the bus, you are no God. So I would go to the bus station. The bus is late, 10 minutes. Then you are God. Master, you must be God. On these small, small things of day-to-day life, I tested him. I said, yes. And he went on passing the test. He wouldn't fail. So I got convinced that if he can manage these little things of life, he must be God. After I tried him 10 or 15 times, his voice I could hear in my head. His voice was very clear. He says, were you testing me out just to find out who I am and then take the next step, or are you going to spend your whole life testing? And I realized I could fool myself just in testing him on these little issues and not saying what is the next thing to do. If he is God and he told me something, I must follow it. Testing period should be over. One should say, all right, I want to test you out. Once it can be a fluke, can be a coincidence, can be an accident. Second time it can be an accident. Third time can be an accident. 10 times is good enough. 20 is good enough. Oh, shouldn't you stop at some time and then move on? That was a good signal he gave that you should move on. When you found from your own experience of little coincidences, of little happenings, that these happenings are coming in a string and they are happening at a stage in my life when they make more sense than anything else. The books and the philosophies are speculative. They say this is possible. But this is not possible. It's happening. These little things are happening in my life. They're not happening in somebody else's life. I'm reading about it. They are happening to me. They are creating faith in me. They are giving me the feeling he's God. He's something more than I realize. He's not mere teacher. That humility is very deceptive. When he says, go and find something better, he's saying so because he knows there is nothing better. And it took me such a long time to find all that. But I went through this. I went through the whole world. I said, maybe in India, we have found out the master. But who knows? The other side, there are countries like United States where they say that's God's own country. I used to hear that there is a country across the oceans. Either you go from the Pacific or the Atlantic, you're on the other side of the earth, and that is called God's own country. On every greenback bill, they print, in God we trust. Here is a country that officially believes in God and realizes that God is the power. Maybe the real masters are there. Maybe I have found the best here, but I missed out on something that was better somewhere else. So in order to get over that feeling, I said, if one day I could go to the other side of this earth, I'd find out they may have maybe a better teacher, better master, more perfect teachings, a higher path than I've ever found. So I should one day get a chance, but then it was so expensive. I knew my father couldn't afford, I couldn't afford, and it cost so much money to buy a ticket. And in those days, when I thought of this, a coincidence happened. A professor from Harvard came, and he said he was selecting some people for going to America. I said, this is too much of a coincidence now. But I know I can't qualify for that, because my record in academics is very topsy-turvy. It's like a roller coaster. I go down, and then I go up, and then I go down. I get a first class, then I get third division, then I get first division. So this is not the kind of person they select. So I have no chance to go through this channel, but maybe this is just a coincidence. So I was interviewed. They said we'll interview 95 people and select 4. So they interviewed 95 and drew a short list, the list of 11. So we select the remaining 4 out of this list. And I was congratulated because I came on the list of 11. And then they selected 4 and I was not there. The 4 people left for the United States. And I said, well, this was a game. I began to realize that great master is mischievous and is playing games. Otherwise, why should this whole plan that I could go to America come at that very time when I was saying there may be a better path there? When I was questioning this thing. And I knew what I had found, but I said, maybe that is hidden from me. I should go and see if it is there, and I can't go. And he arranges everything. And I said, this is going to work because he's arranged it. And I don't want to test him anymore. And he selects 4 from the 11, and I'm left behind. I realized later on, I am the 5th, not the 4th. They drew up a list of 8 people. And they said, if anyone drops out, then we'll move in the list. So naturally, as some of you can guess, one dropped out. And I became the 4th. And I came over. I came. And the day I came, I got admission into a university, which was very difficult in those days. But I got all the labels and all the certificates, Harvard, joined 2 schools, business school, school of government, John F. Kennedy School of Government, and began to study. And went to the university. I said, let me see the American literature on God and masters and truth. And I said, they must have a section on religion, theology, all that, spirituality, truth. So I went there and I found a few students studying the old texts which are available in that university, the Widener University of Harvard. Widener Library of Harvard University. I went to that Widener Library and I looked at the books, and they were translations of the Vedas, of the Sanskrit Vedas. And the people who were studying there for years told me that all the knowledge that we have in this country, which we recognize as the most ancient knowledge on truth, has come either from India, from where I had come to look for it here, or it's come from Egypt, where I'd been recently in studying pyramidology, which fascinated me but didn't contain the truth that I was looking for, or it came from some other sources which were in the Orient. I was so surprised. I read the texts of the Indian spiritual philosophy at Harvard University in America, and it came by coincidence. And I began to go further into it and say, where are the masters? What about the teachers who tell you about the path within? And they said, some of them said, well, we have only one teacher because we believe in the religion, Christian religion, and though we belong to different denominations, one thing is common. We believe Christ is the teacher, the savior. I said, but Christ was crucified. We don't see him anymore. He said, no, but we don't talk of the Christ that you don't see anymore. We talk of the spirit of Christ. That appealed to me. Because the great master used to talk of the spirit of Christ as being the same as the spirit of any master, as being the word, as being the real power within. So that appealed to me. I said, where can I find the spirit of Christ? In retrospect, I find, and today, looking back at those questions I used to ask, I find it is just like one of the movies I saw, Star Trek 4, where they want to go back into a previous century. And one man is looking for nuclear. Anyone remembers that? Yeah. So I was asking like that, where is the spirit of Christ? Where do you keep it? Where do you find it? Who teaches who? And I couldn't find anyone. I said, you must have had a master's here. What about the history of this country? I said, in ancient times, didn't you have masters? They said, we have no ancient history. We have some old history. We can tell you 400 years ago, we tell you about the Civil War, we'll tell you, I read everything about Abe Lincoln, I read about Civil War, I read about this country, and I didn't read anything about the masters. I said, were there no spiritual teachers in this country? How is it possible? Though there are a lot of them. There are more evangelists speaking on the TV, on the radios, here than anywhere else in the world. But there are no spiritual masters. Which shocked me. How can this part of the globe, I thought, may have hidden masters who have got more knowledge than I got from the great master. And here I come and I find there is neither hidden nor unhidden masters at all. Neither present nor in the past. So what is this happening? Here is a country that's God's own country, a country of seekers, a country who talks of God, a country who looks for God. There are no masters here. And they're all talking in maybes and perhaps, and nobody's certain about it. How can that happen? A great eye-opener for me. I went around and I said, there must be some masters guiding you from inside. They said, yes, there are. Masters guide us from inside, and they come from Tibet. They come from White Brotherhood. They are all hidden outside in the Himalayas or in the mountains there. They guide us from inside. I was left with no option but to keep on roaming around. And I said, great master, you gave me a nice merry-go-round trip to find out anything better than what you gave me. I haven't found it, but I'll keep trying. I'll keep trying to the end of my life. But I will not be so serious about it because I tried earnestly to find something who gave better teaching. I couldn't find. Therefore, I now acknowledge, after half my life is over, I acknowledge you are the great master. And I also acknowledge that you being the great master doesn't mean that you individually, one being, one person is the great master. That whoever has that consciousness, whoever can share that experience and consciousness, and control the circumstances of a disciple must be great master. So all masters are great masters. And all masters come and give the same thing. And they are all one. And then, of course, I was able to see from my experience, experience of many of my colleagues, many of the other co-travelers on this path, that when we actually go inside, not talk about it from outside, when we actually go inside, put our attention there, we see all the masters. So I began to take more give more attention to what was going inside and met some people who were constantly going inside and telling us what's going on. And then I met one Muslim, Islamic disciple of Great Master. He was brought up believing the Prophet is the greatest. He lived and died believing the Prophet is the Prophet. And he went inside and had a conversation in the past with Jesus Christ of Nazareth. So it opened up my eyes. And then he found out exactly the relationship of the physical manifestation of one master to another. So great master taught me something really great. That all masters are one. That masters come into this world in their physical embodiment, not for themselves, but for us. Because we have no motivation to go inside.
Therefore, we look outside. And therefore, they express themselves outside. And once we see them outside, their whole purpose of the game is to bring us back inside in a very comfortable way, in a motivated way. That's all. I learned all this from him. And then I found the masters don't come and say, change your religion, change your way of life, change your language, change your dress. They're not concerned with this. This is your social life. You are placed in this world in different circumstances. Live according to your circumstances, but go within. Their emphasis is that continue to do what you are doing. Have your belief systems. If you think that you have a certain religion and a certain spiritual knowledge, go within and you will find out the true meaning of what you already know. If you are a Christian, go within, you'll become a better Christian. If you are a Hindu, go within, you'll become a better Hindu. If you are a Muslim, go within, you'll become a better Muslim. If you want to know whether God is Christian or Hindu or Muslim, go within, you'll find out what denomination belongs to, or if he belongs to all or none. But go within. So great masters' teaching was the teaching of all the masters. And all masters brought this truth home to us in such a beautiful way. So I had to go back and look upon him and see if I went with this feeling to great master that I am going to ask him if he's God. He would say he's not. But if I want to go and talk to him as if he is God, he would give me answers as if God is giving the answer. So he was very playful. I noticed that he left it to me. That if I approached him in one way, he acted like a mirror. If I went with doubts, I am not sure what he is. He would say things, he would say, well, is it the month of May? Make an obvious mistake. I said, no, master, it's April. Oh, I must have looked at the wrong calendar. And we'd say, what kind of master is he? He doesn't even know how to keep his calendar right. Where is he going to take us to God? And when we would talk to him like he's God, give a straightforward answer. Master, am I doing the right thing in this? Yes, go ahead. Certainly. Sometimes we would use just one word with so much effectiveness. Certainly. And things never went wrong when he said certainly. So these different experiences kept on mounting and giving us this feeling that the great master was responding to our needs, our state, our seeking for the truth. And wherever we were, we were responding to that. It also became clear that this was the way of the masters. It also became clear in due course that this is the way of the masters because they are dealing with a very strange combination of consciousness which is operating in pure consciousness coming down from Satchkhand, from the true home, from our real heaven, getting embroiled with a mind that creates the time-space experience of this universe and creates reasoning, logic, then gets embroiled with the senses which give us the feeling that unless you have sensory pleasures, there is nothing worthwhile, cuts the whole experience into good and bad, into pleasurable and painful, into happy and unhappy, and then goes on to fix us into a physical body, which makes us feel this solid world alone is real, and all these things are adjuncts to this world. This strange combination, when we get trapped in this, and start from this end, and start taking this to be real, not that we are starting by saying, there's a reality, we lost it, we want to find it. Supposing that was our attitude. We have a reality, we lost it, we are away from home, we are lost, we want to find. The masters would act very differently. They would take us back. They say, there's the home, don't you see the light? Don't you see the path? This is not the truth. We don't go to the masters saying we are lost here. We say, this world is very nasty. That person was so rude to me. That person talked so badly to me. I can't cope up with this. This relationship is too much for me. I love that person and that person hated me. I love that girl, she jilted me. I love that boy, he gave me up and ran away. I don't want this world, master, help me. We want help in a world we are taking as real. We are not saying we are lost here. We are saying we are weak here. Master, give us your strength so we can work out our relationships and our work, karma better here. Our approach is different. So once we have this approach, the master also changes his approach. He says, all right, let me see how I can help you. But while he is trying to help us, while he is trying to take us on this path, he is gradually building into us an awareness. This is not the real thing that we are here for. That's not the real thing master is really doing. He is doing something under this, which is more subtle, more real. He's taking us back home, that this is not our place. It takes a while. On the spiritual path, it takes a while for us even to know that this is not our place, this is not our home, that we belong somewhere else, that the body that we are wearing is a cover. This is not us. That the senses are not the only means and the only way of having experience. That the mind is not a friend, but can mislead us, and for its own survival is giving us advice and taking us astray. All these things come to us so gradually, one by one, one by one. Then we understand what the real role of the master is. Out of this complex situation, he's pulling us out gently, gradually, and taking us back to the real home. Then we understand the nature of the spiritual path. But it's very difficult. Supposing the master did not give us these gentle hints all the time and did not give us this little help that we need, we would be lost forever. I see no reason for the mind to help us, to take us out from here. Not only I see no reason for the human mind to help us, I see a definite link between the mind's need for survival and its perpetuation of this game of staying here forever. Therefore, if we say, as I said, I want to be rational, I want to shop around, I want to look for the master who is real, I don't want to be just taken for a ride because I was born to certain parents. When I start like this, I can understand what challenge I have created for a master. Because he has to then start with, on my terms of rationality, of logic, yes, it should be acceptable. Yes, it makes sense. Yes, we are in trouble here. Yes, we have not found our way out of this mess. There may be something else. I can tentatively believe in it. There may be levels of consciousness. There may be other regions. There may be other dimensions. There is some world I cannot see. Yes, master, I accept it. Take me gradually. This is rational. So the master operates, making us believe our rationality is what is leading us out of this. Knowing full well that the rationality of the human mind is the one thing that is keeping us down here. So it's a very tricky stage. So in this tricky stage, why we get lost, even though we are seekers, is we want to find our way out with our own minds. Even after we find a master, the compulsion is so strong, we want to find the way with our own mind. And we say, how is it possible? If our mind is sharp enough and logical enough and can give us all the other answers, analyze everything, including analyze what the master is saying, including analyze the path, how come the mind can't take us out? Mind must be able to take us out. And so we try to go out with our own mind. We put effort with our mind. We understand with our mind. We draw diagrams of what it is like to be in the higher regions with our mind. Everything we do with our mind, ultimately, we stay in that frame which the mind fixes up for us almost forever. People have been on the path for a long time. If they thought that they are supposed to understand and use the mind to get out, they have been on it for 40 years, 50 years, if you believe in reincarnation, for lifetime after life. Where is the scope for getting out with one's own mind? But those who have got these subtle hints from the master, that look, the mind can go this far, but will stop there, will not take you anymore. And at that point, look for something else. Those who have taken those hints and tried to look for something other than the mind, and the mind reaches its limit, they have been able to get out. So we are caught in a strange trap where we have so much faith in our own mind. We have such strong faith in our mind that if the mind says, well, it's good for you to have some rest. Don't put in effort. You've been tired, you know. Your health doesn't allow. Your body is sick. You should now give up meditation. This is not the time for you. We so much believe this, we are willing to make a recommendation to the master and to God. Okay, God, since this is the state, give us rest. We don't want to do this. That means instead of finding out what master wants us to do or what God wants us to do, we are willing to give advice to the master and to God because we are trying to find the way with our own mind. This strange relationship with the mind is one of the most fundamental parts of the teaching that great master gave and all masters give. They say the mind is not you, first of all. Don't identify yourself with the mind. Just because you think does not mean that you are the thinker per se. Then who are you? If you can think, then you are not the thinker. Who are you? The master say you are the awareness. A simple thought. I think those are beautiful trees. I'm just taking an example of a thought. I think those are beautiful trees. And look at the trees. These words, I think those are beautiful trees, are spoken words. Not spoken with the tongue. Not spoken with the mouth. But spoken in the head. Spoken with a voice. Whenever we think, even a thought like this, I think those trees are beautiful, it's a voice that speaks in our head. Supposing we were dead, the voice wouldn't speak. If we are alive, the voice speaks. Just because the voice speaks when we are alive, because we are conscious, because we are aware, we start believing, that's me speaking. That's my soul speaking. That's the self speaking. The masters come and touch upon this sensitive issue and say, that's not you speaking. That's your mind speaking. But you are the one that is giving life, consciousness, awareness to the mind to speak. That mind is using your motive force of consciousness and then speaks. Now what do you do in the meanwhile? Mind has taken your consciousness and taken your motive force and start speaking in your head in the form of thoughts. What are you doing in the meantime? You are listening to what he's speaking. So you are still there. The soul is still there. The soul that gave the consciousness to the mind to speak is still there listening to what the mind is speaking. Then what happens? If this were a simple relationship, one would understand it. All right, this mind of mine is constantly speaking to me. I don't want to listen to it. But he jabbers so much, it forces me to listen. It's almost like the ancient mariner holds you down and says, listen to me. Where can you run? I am here speaking to you and you are also there. Where will you run? So you twist and turn, but you listen. That is not bad enough. The masters say, if the mind speaks to you and you are forced to listen, it is not bad enough. It's natural. Because you are confined to a little body, to a little head, to a little space. You are confined to a little space of your own self in which this is happening. But if you recognize that this is the mind speaking and you are being forced to listen, you are in good shape. But this is not what happens. What happens is, we start saying, I am speaking. I am thinking. That's me. I am going to do it. We identify ourselves with the speaker and not the listener. That's the big mistake. That is crucial in the spiritual path. If a person can find out that the soul listens and the mind speaks, the whole problem is over. It is the speaking mind that we listen to that makes it so powerful. When we identify ourselves with that and the mind says, do this, we feel we are going to do this because that's our decision. The mind's decisions become our decisions. The mind decision becomes the decision of the self. And instead of listening to the mind in utter helplessness, we start following the mind and start doing what the mind is telling us. That's the big difference.
You can't stop listening to the mind. Listen to the mind and do what you want. That's the secret. Spiritual path consists of listening to the mind, but not doing what the mind tells you to do. The real spiritual path is listen to the mind, smile at the mind, and do what you want. Well, if you don't know what you want to do, for a trial, for a week or two, you can start doing something other than what the mind says. Do the opposite. Just test it out. Does it work? The mind just spoke in my head and said this, I'm going to do the opposite of that. Today I'll do the opposite, tomorrow I'll follow, three times I'll do this, once I'll do this, I'll follow irrational system. A random system of ignoring the mind. If one can do that, then the masters explain, you are in good shape, because then you can find that you are the soul, not the mind. That soul is consciousness. And what is consciousness made of? You can only find out when you are able to see yourself separated from the mind. Even if you are able to see yourself temporarily, for a few moments, separated from the mind, you'll come to know what you are made of. But if you are constantly thinking that the voice that speaks in your head is you, you'll never find out who you are. Nobody has ever found out the nature of consciousness by studying the nature of thoughts. And that's where the mistake takes place. We start thinking the thoughts are consciousness. No, thoughts are merely a vehicle placed in time, space, causation, in a logical sequence, using our consciousness. Consciousness is not thoughts. Therefore, how do we find out what are we? Who are we? What is consciousness? What are we made of? So when we separate the mind from our own self and look at our consciousness, we find it's the very essence that masters speak of is the nature of God, the Creator. There's no difference. Consciousness is made of the same stuff that the Creator is made of. Consciousness is the same stuff that the Spirit of Christ is made of. Consciousness is the same stuff that the Word is made of. Consciousness is the same stuff that the Master is made of. Consciousness is the real thing, and we can't know who we are. Therefore, we mix it up with the mind, and therefore, we are constantly confusing it with the thoughts of the mind. This is what we have to learn, how to separate the two. How do we learn? How can we, in a practical way, according to the teachings of these great masters, find a way in which we can separate these two? The masters say, very simple. Keep quiet and listen. This is the instruction. Three words contain the whole spirituality. Keep quiet and listen. If you can do that, you found the spirituality. There's a Persian mystic, he says, Khamosh panj nobat vishnos asman. If you can keep quiet, you can hear the five beautiful tones of the word coming from the sky. What he means is, if you do not think, if you do not babble so much with the mind, which means don't give attention to the words of thoughts, if you can sit quietly behind your eyes and not give attention to the words of thought and listen, you will find there is another thing to be listened to besides the mind. That we are not listeners in a vacuum. That we are not listeners forced to become listeners because of the mind speaking to us. Today we think if we suddenly, supposing we didn't think at all, if there was no sound in our head, if the voice of the mind stops, it will be all blank. That is not true. If the mind is not listened to, we automatically listen to our own self, which is the soul. And soul doesn't speak. Therefore, how do we listen to the soul without speaking? The soul's music, the soul's expression is the unspoken word, the unspoken, the unsung music, the endless music. So if the soul is not listening to the music, to the babble of the mind, it begins to listen to the music of itself. And that music takes you through all the higher experiences of the five regions. The five regions means you can experience what you would be if you were in the body. You can experience what you would be without this body, but only the senses. You can experience what you would be if you didn't have the experience of body and senses, only mind and soul. You can experience what you would have if you had no experience of body, senses and mind,
but only soul and totality, and you can have the experience of what you would be if there was only God. All this is possible if we are able to keep quiet mentally and listen spiritually. If we can listen with our soul and keep quiet in our mind, we found the answer. It looks so simple. But then what do we do when such a simple truth comes to us? We start speaking on that too. Make a commentary on that. This is very simple. I'm going to do it today. And all those resolutions come through the spoken word of the mind. And we begin to think those spoken words of the mind are the truth, because they are saying the truth. This is not the way we go about listening. This is the way we go about speaking. So to convert us from speaker to listener is the main object of the masters when they come in their human form and become friends of ours and gradually turn us. How do they turn us? They make us helpless. The more we feel we can control things, the more we speak. Have you noticed that? The more we think we can plan, we can do, we speak a lot. Both vocally and inside our head. When we find nothing is happening the way we want, we start cooling down and speaking a little less. And they ultimately show you who is the doer. Who is the real doer? If you're not the doer, why waste your effort? This kind of experience comes to us in day-to-day life. And then they add it up by experience of different states of consciousness where you don't have to hold on to the outside body or an outside cover in order to have that experience. The two in combination give us the truth that we are looking for. This is the basis of great master's teaching. I'm sharing with you because I found it works well. It gives all the answers. An awareness builds up inside that keeps on giving you answers to all the questions, past, present, and future. You have an awareness sitting inside that lets you know the answer. And you wonder, how can I know the answer before I thought about it? It takes time, but you find out the thought never gave you the answers. Thought only churned those known awarenesses over and over again, but didn't give you the new answers. New answers were with you. Somebody speaks to us. Master comes and tells us something, and we say, that's the answer. But actually that answer never came from the master. It came from us. When he speaks, we brighten up. That we knew. We come to know this was there. Supposing he gave an answer which was not there in our head at all, which was not inside us, we say, we don't understand what he said. It will go over us. Only that part of the answer comes to us which is already there with us. Therefore, sometimes it looks that the answers are coming from outside, they are also coming from inside. The entire knowledge is inside. All the answers are inside. But since we don't believe it, Master builds up our faith gradually. And this building up of faith is very necessary on the spiritual path. Because if we go by experience alone, we say we don't want to have any faith. Show us and we'll go move forward. Show us the next step, we'll take the next step. And then show the next one, we'll take the next one. We'll be stuck on the first step. We are stuck on the first step because we are uncertain. We don't believe in the next step. Therefore, we can't take a step. We are trying to wait on the experience to come so that we can move forward. And moving forward will generate the experience, so we don't know what to do. We are stuck. So at a certain point in life, we give in, we relax a little and say, okay, for now, let me try. Just very often this happens by the pressure of the misery of this world. Very often it happens by the pain of this world, by the pain and suffering of this world. We come under that pressure and we say, okay, we give in for one step only, no more. And that one step leads to a little bit of faith. And that little faith generates an experience. And then it starts moving. Then we find that faith is actually not a blind way of moving in the dark. Faith is different from blind belief. Faith is a substitute for experience at a certain point in life. that when we have experience, we automatically have faith. When we have faith, we have more experience. When we have experience, we get more faith. And more faith is like steps. That we are climbing the steps of conviction and experience for ourselves. But in each alternate stage, we use faith and experience. So faith comes in very handy. The mind likes to attack faith. That is the enemy of faith. The mind doesn't want to have faith. The mind likes to have experience. The mind will believe anything on experience, but not on faith. The spirit, the soul wants faith. I'm willing to go ahead. I know where I came from. I want to fly. I just want to get out. The spirit inside is seeking and yearning for that flight without wondering about how it can happen, where it will happen. The spirit is naturally trying to fly. But the mind says, no, where do you put your foot on? Where are the wings? How do you go? All kinds of questions. The mind is the enemy of faith. While the mind is the enemy of faith, it becomes our enemy too. And the greatest enemy. So much so that when we look at this, when we look at the spiritual path as a whole and want to find, is somebody stopping us from this? Is there a real enemy who doesn't want us to go? We come to the conclusion there's only one enemy. Our own mind. Nobody else. There's no other enemy in this world except our own mind. So we get very disgusted that the enemy was sitting at home inside us. Have you been looking, fighting out the rest of the world and attacking this person, attacking that person, coming out like heroes? We've done a great job. We killed that one and we defeated that one. We did one-upmanship with this one. We come up with all the ego satisfaction that we did so much. And the real enemy was sitting behind, enjoying and saying, wow, I won all these battles. The soul got nothing. The mind inside us was winning all the battles. So if mind is such a great enemy, then that's a very hopeless stage. The masters tell us, the mind is our greatest enemy. But when the mind is put to work and is not listened to, it becomes our best friend. So the mind can undergo a big transformation. That the very mind that is now putting obstacles, if that mind is told what to do, not told verbally, told in the intention of the spirit, if the intention of our soul, the intention of our spirit decides what to do, in spite of what the thoughts say, then the thoughts gradually turn because it is futile. The mind is very practical. The mind will keep on leading us astray so long as we are led astray. Supposing the mind tries to lead us astray once, twice, thrice, and we don't go what the mind is telling us to go, the mind stops telling us. If we start telling the mind, do this, do this, do this, after a few times the mind starts thinking that the mind decided to go there. It is fond of forming habits and it is subject to change. If we can hold our own with the mind and go on the spiritual path, not listen to the mind, after a while the mind starts coming along with us and doesn't regret it at that time. Because when the mind starts coming with us, the mind is fond of pleasures and finds in the dark, boring stage of meditation also, you pass that dark stage, there is a lot of pleasure. And once it crosses that threshold of the darkness of the eyelids and begins to see the light, the mind runs for it and becomes a friend. So one of the beauties of the spiritual path as given by practical masters is they help us to make the mind into a friend instead of an enemy. And therefore, the mind then comes along with us. The mind enjoys that because mind is not a small power attached to the consciousness. It is the creator of whole concept of time and space. This time, space, this big vastness that we see, this vastness of spaces and universe that we create is created by the mind. So the mind in its higher form, we only see the mind in its physical form here. But the mind has an astral form and the mind has a causal form. Mind has a universal causal form. So the mind itself is a beautiful, huge experience. And when you take the mind along with you to its own home, the mind feels as happy running to its own home as the soul feels happy going to its own home. Therefore, the journey becomes interesting for both. So the masters come and take us from a state where the mind is coming in our way and interrupting our spiritual growth to a stage where the mind becomes a friend and goes along with us. This simple turn takes place because of one strange thing, strange power the masters use with us. They don't use the mind's power too much. They know we have to give up that. They don't try to convince us by reason all the time. They convince us up to a point because they know we are trapped in the game of being convinced and then taking the next step. So they convince us up to a point. They add a few coincidences, little miracles around, throw a few miracles to keep us going. And once they find that we are going with the little miracles and that the mind is convinced that there must be something here and the thing looks rational, after that they concentrate wholly on the other function, which is not mental or mind function at all, which is purely a spiritual soul function, and that is love. They ultimately come round to say the real path is the path of love. Because when they touch us with love, the mind is left aside. We as human beings live in this world and we are sometimes touched by love. Not necessarily divine love of God or love of a master, just love. Love of a person. We are sometimes touched by being attracted to a person, falling in love, feeling we can't get the person out of our head. You know, sometimes we look at a person and something happens to us and we can't get that person out of our head. And even when we try to, we just can't think of but the person. We want to do something and we start feeling like the other person is still there. This kind of feeling of love which comes to us is the only feeling in this physical world that puts our mind aside on second place. Otherwise, for everything else, the mind occupies position number one. The mind occupies the driver's seat in our life, except for the experience of love when the mind is willing to take the back seat. Therefore, in this physical world, to pull us out from this world and to change the nature of the mind, they use this beautiful method of love. They use this beautiful experience of love. They use love as their only way. Love becomes the way. So all the masters, when they have come here, their way has been love. And they have touched us with love. When everything has been passed through and you have got your doubts, you got your questions, you got your tests for the master, you got your tests whether God exists or does not exist, and what form he exists, when you passed all the intellectual phases, ultimately the path becomes a path of love. And they touch us with the love and we are drawn, and that love takes us back home that nothing else can take us. Therefore, their real path is a spiritual path that takes us only through love. So that love is the one we wait for. When we follow the master, we follow with love. When we wait for the master, wait for love, we forget the philosophies. For a while, the philosophies, methods, understandings are important, and eventually everything gives way. Love for the master, love of the master, what is our relationship, is the mind begins to take second place. So this is, in short, the path of the masters. I went through all this phase from childhood and have come up to you today on this Bhandara day to share with you that this is what came by knowing a great master. Just by knowing him, just by finding a man who had that consciousness, who had that awareness, and by interacting with him, this is what happened to me. I think it's a good deal that happened to me. I am very happy with it. I haven't found a better deal. I want to compliment everybody who can have a deal like this. I have looked at many deals. I don't find a deal like this. Therefore, I pay tribute to the great master. I pay tribute to him that he, like other masters, and all masters are the same, like other masters, he walked upon this earth. He not only walked upon the earth, gave us the benefit of this personal association, and through that association made this experience possible. Not only that, by his personal association, he was able to handle the problem of the mind which I found was not possible to handle in any other way. I still, it's an open question to everybody. If you find a way, tell me. I'm open to conviction on this. If there is any other way that you can handle the mind, I'll be very happy to add that to the repertory of methods. I have not found any other way. When we are acting on our own, supposing we say we got the truth, truth is inside, and we can do it on our own, let's go ahead. Now, master, your job is over. You told us truth is inside, and now we're going to go inside. You stay where you are. Now we'll go on our own. Supposing we try that, what will happen? The mind will make up all kinds of images. The mind will say, this is master telling you this now. Don't go inside. There's enough outside. Go walk up there. Do this, do that. And we'll say, master, thank you from inside. Master is not there at all. The mind is there. How can we let go of the only safeguard we have against the mind playing these games with us? When mind starts playing games, there is no safeguard except to be able to go to the one who attacks our mind and says, this is not you. This is not me. This is not our reality. Therefore, a living master today, if I were to say, you people are very lucky. Great master, Hazur Maharaj Baba Sawan Singh has walked upon this earth. Therefore, you are lucky. I am fooling all of you. He can do nothing because he is not physically there. We are commemorating him because he physically passed away. Only spirit is here. And you have to find the spirit again in a living form. It's always been like this. You will find him if you go by finding somebody who is now in human form and can share this with you. And in human form, be a safeguard to your mind playing tricks with you. If that can happen, then you can find out who great master is, and all masters are great. Therefore, the mind plays these tricks, and a living master is the only safeguard. I traditionally bring a cup with me. You've seen that cup, some of you? It's a silver cup. The great master used all his life. For 40 years, took sips of water out of that. It's a sentimental thing for me. You haven't seen, many of you haven't seen, maybe some of you have, I can't say, because some of you are young, could have been there in another body. But that's a beautiful, sentimental thing for me, to have the cup which the great master used. And this is the only day I keep it covered and safe. This is the day when I want to share, because I feel great master is still very much alive and kicking for me. And I find him all over. And I find him walking the streets of this, of several cities in this country. And I see him globe-trotting and spending so much of time in the United States, so I get a little concerned. I say, why are you here? And then he reminds me that he had told an American disciple, Dr. Julian Johnson, way back, that spirituality, the axis will shift to this country. So I always have a feeling that the great master's presence in this country is to show that the seekers who waited so long, with no perfect mystic in human form to help them, who were led by delusion, who were led by ritual and ceremony, who were led by nothing but the external forms of worship and never found the truth inside. Though, but they were real seekers. They have a chance. They are able to find something real now. So I feel very happy. The great master said, there will be masters, perfect living masters in abundance in this country. Many of them are going to be born. And then I remember these words of great master, that so much is going to happen in this country. I run here, go to Clarence Brinson, and I take a job. I say, give me a job. I want to be here. I want to take a ringside seat right now when the great show takes place, because the show is going to take place here. I have it on the authority of the great master. So that is why I feel this is a great opportunity taking place here. That is why I congratulate you on this Bhandara Day. I don't congratulate you that you found great master. I congratulate you that you are now situated as seekers of the truth in a place where masters can be found, where great masters can be found in living form, the same form that I found the great master. And that is the best tribute that I can pay to him, that he did not hide things for an exclusive group somewhere, but he made it available for all the seekers anywhere, including this part of the world. So that beautiful cup, which is sentimental for me, I will show you in the afternoon session. Then I also have another great master's shoes, Baba Pratap Singh of Tarn Taran, who is still alive and lives in India. Clarence Brinson tried to bring him over here. And he doesn't want to travel anywhere, but when he said with affection, why don't you come there? He said, yes, I will come. Then later on he told me, I'm not going there. I said, why? He said it with so much affection. He said, no, he just wants to use me to show off to other people. So we found him out. We found Clarence out. We wanted to bring him out to show him to other people. But although we couldn't bring him over, at least he one day, Johnny was there with me when the shoes were given. Another friend of ours, Johnny was there, and he gave his shoes, which he just got. He says, take them. And I took them, wear them. I said, no, I am going to carry them near my heart. Some months later, he told me, had you carried on your head, you would have got even more than you carry on the heart. So I put them on my head, and I remembered the old story, which I had forgotten, about the relevance of these little things that are not important by themselves. Now, I have so much respect for that cup and for these shoes, which I am going to share with you. If you like to touch, I can let you touch the shoes this evening in the afterglow. But the relevance is not in the thing. There's nothing in the shoes. They're like any other shoes. There's nothing in the cup. It's like any other cup. It's the association I have with the cup that makes it real, makes it unusual. It is what is happening in my consciousness in relation to the cup that is making it unusual, not the cup itself. One should remember the truth is still the cup. The beauty of the cup is inside, not in the cup outside. So I want to share this without saying that I am going to set up another ritual. The ritual on Bhandara day, have a look at the cup and you'll get something. Not true. I have not come here to create rituals. I am not a follower of a master who said set up rituals and superstitions. I follow great master who said, get out of all superstitions. Get out of all these rituals. Go inside and find the truth. Don't look at anything outside as real, whether they are cups or shoes or anything. Why I share with you is because of the sentiment attaching to them. So those shoes also I will share with you later in the day. And I'll conclude this morning session with that story about the king who was a disciple of a master in New Delhi. And he decided that it's no use wasting his time in that little princely kingdom, that he should wind up everything, put all his valuables and go and put his head on the feet of the master and do something real spiritually, rather than just going about doing the worldly business of running a kingdom. So he's packed up all his belongings on horses and camels and elephants, and laden with jewels and all the wealth of that kingdom, he came in a caravan of horses and all the other animals, and they were going. While he was proceeding like this, it took several days to go to Delhi. There was a poor man, a poor disciple of the same master, who wanted to get his daughter married and needed some cash for that, to buy dowry and to buy gifts and to arrange a party. So he went to the master, that poor man, and he said, Master, I have to get my daughter married and I have no money. Can you give me something? You are my only hope. People take you like God. God is the giver, can give everything. So why don't you give me something? And the master said, well, business has been a little dull, you know, these days. Not too many donations have come. Whatever came has been eaten away by people.
You see, he looked around him and said, there's nothing much here. And that man was a little disappointed that I went to this master thinking he is God. He's the giver. He can give anything. And he's nothing around him. So when the master saw his plight, he said, I have those shoes of mine. Maybe you can take those shoes. They may be worthwhile. So at least that's all I can give you right now. So he picked up his old shoes and gave to this poor man. And he walked out with those shoes. And he said, maybe these are worth a couple of bucks. I can have my next meal in exchange for the shoes. So thinking the shoes are worth $2 and he'll get a meal for that, he wrapped them around and walked in the street. And as he was walking, that was the time when the king with all his caravan was coming, entering. And the king was feeling, I am near the master now. I can see his, feel his vibrations. I can smell him. Oh, master, I know the direction is right. And this poor man walked by and went the other side. He said, he sniffed. He says, wow, master, you are this side. Why is this? This fragrance that was coming from you has gone this way. So he saw this man had just passed him. He says, hold on, young man, have you seen that master? He said, yes, I'm just coming from him. He said, I knew that. This kind of vibration cannot come from anybody, but from somebody who has just seen the master. Do you have something that belongs to the master? He said, well, I just have these old shoes. The master gave them to me. I just have these shoes. He says, would you be willing to trade them for something I can give you? Certainly. He said, I was going to sell them anyway. He says, I'll buy them. Give them to me and I'll buy them. So he took the shoes. He said, in exchange for these shoes, all these elephants, all these horses, all these camels, all the wealth on them is yours. Take away everything. And I want only the shoes. So the man said, this master is real. He made a miracle. It's not worth $2. This is worth so much. I can have a good wedding for my daughter. So he went happy. And this king said, this master is real. He sent me his message before I even reached him. So both got happy. And this king with shoes on his heart went to the master. And he bowed his head on his feet and said, master, thank you for remembering me even before I reached you. So master laughed. He said, oh, you got the shoes? He said, yes, master. He said, what did you pay for them? He said, oh, I gave my horses and camels and all the diamonds and jewelry, whatever was laden on that, I gave to that man and got the shoes. The master said, you still got them cheap. So master also has had a sense of humor. Bhandara also has traditionally got some food cooked. And from great master's days, in my early childhood, the Bhandara was small, 40, 50 people used to come, then it grew. I saw it growing to 75, 80, 100, 200 people. And when great master passed away in 1948, it had gone to the last Bhandara, just before he passed away, gone up to hundreds of thousands of people coming. And one thing they used to share was the langar, or the food cooked with love and devotion, people singing, making food, and, you know, having a feeling of service and love, the spirit of the path in a, as a way of life. So people enjoyed the simple food that they used to cook, and some would carry the food with them as prasad, that this blessed food, it's come on a Bhandara day. So I suppose our kind friends here have also been working with love and devotion, cooking some food here, which we'll participate in, partake of now, and enjoy the food. And if something is left over at night, we can carry it with us as prasad of great master, and get that feeling of the Bhandara of the great master, thus paying a tribute to the existence of such men upon this earth who can so transform our life and give us the way inside. Thank you very much. Let's enjoy the food that they have.